Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. Human beings around the world may be witnessing one of the most significant dramas in the modern history of the space sciences. The European Space Agency's Rosetta mission to the comet 67P has shattered the theoretical predictions of standard comet theory. For many decades, we were told that comets are dirty snowballs, which formed billions of years ago, tracing back to the solar system's origins. If comets are indeed primordial aggregates of ices and dust, then they should have very smooth nuclei covered with abundant water ice. Several previously imaged comets had already falsified this expectation. Nevertheless, Rosetta scientists fully expected the nucleus of 67P to be cold, smooth, and covered with ice. In November, the team will attempt to use harpoons and ice screws to secure a lander on the comet's dry, extremely rocky surface. As millions of observers around the world can see with their own eyes, 67P provides a stunning refutation of the standard comet theory. Not a single trace of water ice has been observed on the comet's surface. Instead, its burnt black as coal terrain is tortured with numerous cliffs, pits, craters, rocks, and boulders. It is as far from a dirty snowball as one can imagine. For decades, the prediction of the electric universe has been that comets, asteroids, and meteors were excavated electrically from planetary surfaces. Consider this side-by-side comparison of comet 67P and the Sawtooth Mountains in New Mexico. Let us ask ourselves, which of the competing comet theories most closely predicted the features of 67P? We asked Wal Thornhill for his summary of the Rosetta mission to date, beginning with the most fundamental flaw in standard comet theory, the notion that comets are primordial.
The European Space Agency, ESA, named the Rosetta mission after the Rosetta Stone, a key discovery in human history that allowed us to unlock critical components of our own history. ESA chose that name because they wanted the mission to provide a bridge to the past of our solar system, the same way that the original Rosetta Stone provided a bridge to an ancient culture that had previously not been understood. Now, there's some irony in this because the ancient Egyptians remain misunderstood because we project onto them our unquestioned belief that their environment looked the same as our environment does today. As a result, many mysteries about their astronomy still beg explanation but are ignored. The same is happening with comets, where we have an unquestioned belief about their origin, which renders researchers blind to anomalies that should consign comet theory to the trash bin of history. A NASA news report in August titled, "To Catch a Comet by the Tail, Rosetta's Historic Meet and Greet with Churyumov Gerasimenko," highlights the problem in its introduction. And I quote, "Scientifically speaking, comets are complex remnants from the very earliest times in our solar system. They accreted or grew out of the same spinning gas cloud that gave rise to the Sun." End of quote. This statement is not scientific. It's merely a once-upon-a-time, long, long ago, and far, far away bedtime story. No one has observed a star or planets forming in such a way. In fact, the most recent evidence shows stars forming non-gravitationally along glowing filaments in molecular clouds, and thousands of exoplanetary systems make our solar system look the odd one out. We're also told, in this report, and I quote, "Because of their stealth and seeming unpredictability, comets have traditionally invoked terror, suspicion, and awe in humankind." End of quote. What research shows this? All forensic investigations into the earliest references to comets identify the archetypal Doomsday Comet with a highly visible planet, Venus. Space scientists know nothing about history and so fail to learn from it. Stealth and unpredictability are no answer to our fear of comets. The possibility that within human memory the planetary system has been unstable and nonetheless achieved clockwork stability within that brief period challenges Newtonian dynamics and is dismissed without a moment's thought. But the singular defining feature of a comet is its elliptical orbit, its motion toward and away from the Sun. It requires an electrical model of the solar system to explain a comet's appearance and non-gravitational orbital changes. Clearly, a comet nucleus the size of Venus would invoke terror, suspicion, and awe in humankind. But NASA's misinformation doesn't end there, and I quote, "Previous comet-centered missions have revealed just enough to allow us to unseat prevailing theories, but not enough to firm up new ones." End of quote. This is pure spin doctoring. There has been no change in the prevailing theory of comets, just ad hoc adjustments to a centuries-old story. Tradition dies hard. And as for new theories about comets, what are they? But for me, this statement takes the cake, and I quote, "In 2005, NASA threw a coffee table-sized spacecraft at Comet Temple. The resulting deep impact explosion was shallower than anticipated, but nonetheless implied that comets may be more porous than previously thought, and not armored with an icy exterior or shell." End of quote. So the flash before the main outburst didn't happen? The ad hoc explanation at the time was that the impactor must have hit a hard shell before burying itself in softer material and causing an unexpectedly dazzling outburst to follow. I alone predicted both the initial flash, the energetic outburst, and a shallow crater due to hitting solid rock. Now NASA scientists tell us that the crater is shallow because stuff fell back and partly filled the crater. This assumes a half-witted audience that thinks of the Earth's gravity operating on the comet. But even on Earth, how much debris from a massive ground explosion falls back into the crater? If NASA's researchers were asked to give evidence in court as expert witnesses, they would be a laughingstock. Their stories make no sense whatsoever. So what of the Rosetta mission so far? The Rosetta mission to Comet 67P is providing us with unprecedented close-up images of a comet's surface. But the most remarkable thing to see is the selective blindness of researchers caused by prior beliefs about what a comet is supposed to be, a primordial ball of dust and ice. And I quote, "It was so surprising to see that this is not a smooth, hull-shaped body as we've thought it would be," said Holger Siex, the lead scientist behind OSIRIS, Rosetta's 4-megapixel camera. The scientists are still putting together why the comet might have such an odd shape. "One possibility is that P67 is actually two comets that have been fused together," he says, "although it's also possible the comet was somehow carved, through impacts or some other unknown force, into this strange figure." End of quote. It seems we're about to have another concocted explanation that leaves the scientists comfortable with the old story and business as usual. That there is no surface ice is a big surprise to the scientists, many of whom expected to find a glassy, clean surface of crystal ice to screw the lander harpoons into. But, they say, the comet still is icy below the surface. We see water coming out, so there must be a way for the water to escape. These are statements of faith in the old dirty snowball model, not facts, as we shall see. The rubber duck-shaped comet is clearly rocky and complex. It shows stratification, craters with fluted walls, areas that seem to have been formed by a flow of some sort, and peaks aligned like part of a broken-off mountain range. In other words, the comet looks more like a scarred fragment of a planet's surface than a dirty snowball. And despite the absence of ice, there are faint jets just over the horizon that show the comet seems to be suffering a form of surface erosion at the neck of its odd rubber duck shape. But there are no signs on the comet neck of neat holes forming venturis needed to produce narrow vertical jets from sublimating subsurface ices. This complex scenario follows the tradition of astrophysicists invoking hidden activity within stars and planets to explain awkward observations. Many features on the nucleus appear to be the result of electric spark erosion, which forms scalloped or fluted cliffs about an etched depression or crater. This process can be seen clearly in action on Jupiter's moon Io. But then there's the question of why the jets seem to be issuing preferentially from the neck region. Spark erosion takes place in the form of vertical cathode jets, which are initiated where the electric field is strongest, on sharp points or edges, and where the surface composition is most readily ionized. This suggests that the mineral composition in the neck of the comet may be different to that in the attached lobes, and such preferential erosion may be responsible in part for forming the neck and rubber duck shape. Talking about composition of the comet's density, measured by its gravitational influence on the Rosetta spacecraft, will give an entirely misleading idea of the comet's composition. The reason is simple, although inexcusable in the 21st century. It's the confusion by physicists of mass with quantity of matter. For more than a century, scientists should have known, according to E equals mc squared, that the mass of subatomic particles is an energetic variable dependent on the local electrical environment. That is why the so-called universal constant of gravitation is so maddeningly inconstant. The comet's environment is quite unearthly. As a result, I confidently predict that the chemical and physical makeup of the comet will confound researchers. The nucleus looks like solid rock because it is solid rock.
The failure to observe a single trace of water ice on the surface of Comet 67P has not deterred investigators from the assumption that substantial water ice must still be present, but is hidden from view under the comet's surface. Proponents of the standard theory point to evidence of water detected in cometary comas as proof that comets are indeed icy bodies, slowly sublimating from solar heating. However, what is spectroscopic analysis really telling us about comets? A clue to this question may be provided by recent scientific papers. In a 1998 paper on the formation of Mercury's ice deposits, the authors write, "Oxygen-containing surface rocks could release water through sputtering by protons from the solar wind." On October 7th of this year, phys.org featured the headline, "Study shows most water in lunar soil generated by solar wind." The article states, "A pair of researchers has determined that most of the water in the soil on the surface of the moon was formed due to protons in the solar wind colliding with oxygen in lunar dust." Institutional science has never explored electrochemical processes creating the signal of water in cometary comas. Indeed, as Wal Thornhill tells us, the science of electrochemistry may reveal that spectroscopic instruments are not detecting water at all.
So what about the measurements that are interpreted as several liters of water issuing from the comet per second? The cathode jets strip and ionize atoms of oxygen from minerals on the comet and accelerate the negative ions away in a fine jet. The oxygen ions then combine with the protons in the solar wind to form the hydroxyl radical, or OH, which is mistakenly assumed to be evidence of an ultraviolet breakdown product of water molecules from the comet. Oxygen and hydrogen have both been found in the comet's coma by the Rosetta ultraviolet spectrometer. It should be noted that the earlier Stardust mission supported this by finding surprising high-temperature minerals in comet dust. This fits the picture of comets as highly modified planetary debris, rather than being primordial. There is no need to invent ever more special conditions and add-ons to the age-old solar nebula story of solar system formation. That story has been discredited both theoretically and with each new discovery about comets, asteroids, and weird extrasolar planetary systems. One planetary scientist admitted that he needs a separate theory for each planet in our own solar system.
The double-lobed form of Comet 67P is considered one of its most extraordinary and baffling features. Indeed, this basic form has been seen on several comets, including comets Halley, Borelli, and Hartley, and additionally numerous asteroids. As described in several previous videos, this form is no surprise to proponents of the electric universe. Several years ago, plasma scientist C.J. Ransom replicated this form in the laboratory with a high-energy electrical discharge to a mineral surface. Scientists have proposed that a low-velocity collision between two comets occurred in the past, then mysteriously melded together to create 67P's double-lobed body. But as Wal Thornhill explains, this ad hoc theory stretches credulity beyond any reasonable breaking point.
According to the old solar nebula theory, comets are far-flung leftovers from the birth of the solar system. They are supposed to have formed by accretion in a hypothetical Oort cloud. But this imaginary Oort cloud is unlike any cloud we are familiar with. The cloud is about 1,000 times further out than the orbit of Pluto. And the mean distance between comets is about 1 billion kilometres. So collision and accretion have negligible probability. Yet we look at Comet 67P and its surface cratering would appear to require countless impacts. What's more, its shape is entirely unaccountable by accretion. The impact of two largest chunks would rather disintegrate them instead of somehow welding them together to form a rubber duck. The problem for planetary scientists is that their expert advice from astrophysicists is based on another old and flawed story about star formation that has also been discredited by recent observations. Stars form deep inside molecular clouds like beads strung along glowing cosmic strings. The cosmic strings are the galactic equivalent of earthly cloud-to-cloud lightning. The powerful electromagnetic pinch acts to compress and heat matter along the lightning channel. The result on Earth is merely a thunderclap, but you can't hear a thunderclap in space. Instead, we see a string of stars. Of course, smaller bodies will form planets, which, when the lightning has subsided, form gravitational partnerships. This simply explains the weird exoplanetary systems with hot Jupiters swinging around their star in hours or days, and planets with backward orbits and orbits over the star's poles. As Hans Alfvén, the father of modern plasma physics, remarked, gravitational systems are the ashes of prior electrical systems. The old nebula accretion theory of planet formation is long dead and must be buried. As for Comet 67P, arc welders know that an electric arc can transfer matter against the ultra-weak force of gravity. So if the fillet landing is successful, it will be important to examine the mineral composition of the comet and compare it with Martian meteorites, since Mars bears colossal recent electrical scars. Even with Rosetta information, we will not understand the Egyptians and their pantheon of weird celestial gods, much less what comets are, until we leave our comforting bedtime stories behind. Newton's law of gravity does not guarantee a peaceful clockwork solar system lasting for eons. Astronomers know, but can't accept the unsettling idea, that Newton's solar system is chaotic on a very short timescale. The reason is simply that gravity alone provides no restoring force when one planet disturbs another. Astronomers also know little about history. Clearly, they are missing something very important, and ironically, the answer has been hidden in plain view of those who study the oldest human histories, which tell of planetary wars involving thunderbolts of the gods. That these ancient stories did not relate to everyday lightning is shown by the many images of those thunderbolts. The implications for the recent history of the planets are paradigm-shattering. It seems that charge exchange plays a significant role in stabilizing orbits, and in close encounters the effect is to electrically gouge surface material from one planet and transfer it to the other. In the process, a great deal of debris is lost to space, where it becomes asteroids, comets, and meteoroids.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.